Thank you all for being here. So I make my screen shared. Research is focused on four main answers. As Laura mentioned, I started my research and gained my PhD on the neurophysiological evaluation of cognitive and or physical training through interventions that induced neuroplasticity. I mainly used for evaluation functional connectivity analysis, initial on the sensor level and later on the cortical level. Apart from functional connectivity analysis, we also employed graph theory tools in order to estimate the network performance through graph theory tools. And lately we applied deep learning algorithms like the convolutional neural network to try to predict the brain age marker, which we use as an index of cognitive reserve and cognitive capacity. Previously, in my master thesis, I applied some machine learning tools for emotion-aware computing in order to investigate gender differences during affective processing and to classify emotions based on neurophysiological signals. Lately, in my postdoc studies focused on space medicine, and we employed tools for automated sleep staging through polysomnographic studies and to evaluate sleep quality and efficiency through cortical connectivity analysis, resting state networks, and how the brain cortical activity is correlated with biomarkers that affect sleep. Very lately, during the previous year, we started the artificial gravity training laboratory, and we perform studies for optimal intensity prediction, and we use these estimations to propose the optimal artificial gravity training for patients suffering from neurodegeneration or mobility difficulties with the precision context framework. So functional connectivity analysis is mainly performed by extracting artifact-free sensor data, then analyzing them with the orthogonal discrete wavelet transform. We estimate relative energy contributions for each EEG band, and then we apply the relative wavelet entropy as a connectivity metric, and we form the brain networks. Also, we examine some network properties like the small volt propensity to investigate if they change according to the cognitive status as estimated through neuropsychological training. For example, you see here a study that found found that smallholder property is significantly proportional to both the mini mental state examination and the Montreal cognitive assessment test that are able to discriminate healthy senior citizens from those suffering from mild cognitive impairment and mild dementia. And through centrality metrics, like the between centrality, you see here that these are the function, the statistically significant functional hubs of healthy participants. And then we see that during the transitional stage of amnestic mild cognitive impairment, the posterior hubs diminish, and there are some initial hubs on the right anterior or right anterior positions. And we see that during the clinical onset of mild dementia, those right anterior hubs mainly diminish and fewer remain. The most remarkable and most novel finding of this study is that we found that amnestic MCI patients have similar functional disorganization when compared to those with mild dementia. However, their cognitive status remained relatively intact. And this motivated us to hypothesize that some compensatory mechanisms occur even in the mature human brain. These compensatory mechanisms are reflected in the formation of the anterior hubs. And finally, we employed big data and deep learning architectures to try to predict the brain age compared to the actual age of the participant. And we used this marker in order to discriminate through a machine learning perspective healthy and demented patients, and also young from healthy senior citizens. And you may see here that the accuracy was quite remarkable and reached almost 90%. We also employed event-related potentials to estimate gender differences through affective picture processing. And then we employed these neurophysiological tools in order to develop a machine learning approach that could discriminate the emotional content that participants view. Here you see an early study that developed a decision tree, which was a quite explainable model and was according to neurophysiological and expert evidence and reached almost 80%. And then we employed support vector machines. Although this approach resembles a black box architecture, like the majority of machine learning approaches, it reached higher accuracy, around 82%. After completing my master and my PhD, I organized and led the activities of the Biomedical Engineering and Aerospace Neuroscience BIN group, It focuses on the assessment of sleep quality in long-term space missions and extreme environments like microgravity simulation or living in the International Space Station. An Earth application of those space-related approaches focuses on the estimation of human fatigue in critical working environments like civil aviation, transportation, or hospitals, especially during the pandemics. The tools we employ are the connectomics for assessing mental and cognitive functioning. So you may see here the Envy Hub laboratory inside the DLR, which is a German aerospace agency located in ports outside Cologne Airport. And we employed there a head down tilt, better rest stats for 60 days in order to simulate the microgravity environment. You may see here a participant who remained in that position 24 hours per day for 8 weeks, 2 months. Our hypothesis is that an isolated and confined environment like this one in the Envy Hub or during their stay, the astronauts stay on the International Space Station, changes in circadian rhythms occur, and this is associated with increased stress, elevated sleep disturbances, like reduced sleep duration and reduced sleep quality reflected by staying more minutes in light sleep and less minutes in deep sleep. Awake and arousal events also occur often, and those lead to increased irritability, anger, and mood disorders that are associated with poor cognitive performance, social problems, and they could even endanger crew relationships and mission accomplishments. So this is a relatively big problem in isolated and confined environment. And the scientific community investigates robust countermeasures to alleviate those detrimental effects. Sorry. You may see here our approach on cortical activity estimation through the S. Loretta approach. And we estimate cortical activity, and then we form cortical regions of interest. For each cortical region of interest, we estimate its activity, and then we apply our pipeline analysis. Sorry. You may see here some modular architectures of the human brain. And this is an example of how our brain dynamically reconfigures architecture and investigates different cortical organization. Then we apply graph theory tools such as the mean cluster coefficient, the node degree, the characteristic path length, and small world property in order to estimate how closely a node is connected to its neighbors. This is a metric of local information processing, and also how fast information from a specific region or electrode travels to different regions. The faster the information flow and the strongest the local information processing, then the more efficient the network architecture is. And this is estimated either by small world property or small world propensity measures. So this is our pipeline. We start from EEG or PSG data collection. We pre-process the sensor data in order to result in artifact-free epochs of high quality. Then we estimate cortical activity through generic head anatomy modeling. We estimate cortical time series for each one of the colored regions, and then we apply cortical functional connectivity analysis, either by relative wavelet entropy, synchronization likelihood, mutual information, coherence, etc., in order to form the brain networks and to apply the graph theory analysis. A major part of our research focused on developing an automated staging algorithm. Until a few years ago, almost all the sleep staging methods used traditional biomedical signal processing analysis in order to estimate, in order to quantify the sleep staging. However, those approaches were greatly unreliable to the scientific sleep medicine community, and their acceptability was limited. What we changed is that instead of using traditional signal processing algorithms either on the time or in the frequency space, we employed connectivity metrics and graph theory estimations. So our approach is to shift from an engineering level to a dynamic system modeling. And we employed also big data analytics and deep learning tools like the convolutional neural networks. And we transformed the EEG time series to RGB images. And we focused on default mode network activations, and we performed functional connectivity estimations. One problem that we initially faced is that non-REM1 sleep stage, which is regarded as a transitional stage from awakeness and drowsiness to sleep, is represented by only 1 or 2% of the total sleep time. So most of the algorithms were biased to and focused to correctly identify sleep stages like N2, N3 or REM that represented a great portion of the total sleep time and neglected the N1 stage. So our novelty is to employ the synthetic minority oversampling technique, the SMOLT algorithm, and in that case, from having 121 epochs of N1 duration, we made surrogate N1 epochs more than 1,000. And these are the RGB images that are the representation of the EEG time series of each sleep epoch. This is the network architecture. It is not a relatively deep network architecture. It consists of five layers. However, this was more than enough since it resulted in the highest accuracy rate that was reported till that time by automated sleep staging algorithms. And this resulted in a publication in a high impact IEEE Transactions of Neural Networks and Learning Systems Journal. Then we analyzed the actual connectivity features, and we seek to find if there are any alterations during the transitional N1 sleep stage. And we mainly focused on alpha oscillatory activity, since we knew that alpha activity reaches its peak during the dozeness period and then diminishes during a good sleep. What we found is that the main effect of time among the baseline period and the bed rest head down tilt period. And this was mainly found in the 21st day of the bed rest study. We used the net-based statistics toolbox for the analysis, and our analysis resulted in 227 statistically significant edges. I neglected to mention that the study participants were divided either to a control group or to a group that performed training through the reactive sleds jump countermeasure. However, no time by group interaction was found, and this was evident that the proposed countermeasure was not very robust in order to mitigate the microgravity detrimental effects on sleep onset. Then we followed an approach that investigate interactions between prolactin, glucose, and insulin biomarkers with sleep macro architecture features like total sleep time, arousal, awakenings, the N1 duration, and the alpha oscillatory activity during the N1 stage. And what we found during baseline is that statistically significant network, the yellow lines represent positive correlations, and the blue lines represent negative correlations. And you may see here that the glucose biomarker is inversely correlated with arousal. On the other hand, insulin is positively correlated with both awakenings and N1 duration, which both are markers of poor sleep quality. Alpha rhythm was positively correlated with total sleep time. So the more alpha we have on the transition from drowsiness to sleep, the more we actually sleep. And also the more frequent arousal events are correlated with prolonged N1 duration and elevated total sleep time. And only glucose seems to have a sleep promoting role. On the other hand, insulin seems to be a quantifiable marker of sleep duration. And finally, arousal is the central node of this statistically significant network, since it connects the different branches of the network. Among the period of 14 to 21 days of bed rest, we see that both glucose and prolactins are statistically negatively correlated with the sleep onset. And also insulin and N1 duration are positively correlated with awakenings. The thicker the line, the strongest the correlation is. And also we found a negative correlation here between arousal and alpha oscillatory activity. And total sleep time was unconnected with the other nodes. The similar pattern was observed between the 14 and 30 days of bed rest studies. However, fewer edges survived the statistical significance. And we see here that between 21 and 30 days, there is a positive correlation between insulin and prolactin and a negative correlation with prolactin and sleep onset. And again, N1 duration is positively correlated with the number of awakenings. On the other hand, the number of arousals were negatively correlated with alpha power. Then we performed some correlations between the glucose biomarker and the statistically significant functional connectivity edges that identified in the previous step. You see, you may observe here that between the baseline and 30 days after the bed rest study, there are some significant edges among the auditory and temporal cortices of the two hemispheres. And when estimating the entire period from 14 to 30 days, we observe that interhemispheric correlations do not survive the statistical test, and we have only interhemispheric correlations, apart from that case on the posterior occipital cortex. You may see here the statistically significant results for prolactin correlations with functional connectivity. The findings are fewer than the glucose. On two different nodes of the superior temporal gyrus. Then we employed a machine learning tool to predict sleep quality based on the biomarkers, and we employed regression analysis using the three biomarkers, prolactin, glucose, and insulin as predictors of sleep macro architecture. The analysis were performed in our studio, and you see here that prolactin and glucose were mostly significant in the majority of the seven models that we built, and only in one insulin was highly significant, and this verifies that glucose and prolactin are important for predicting sleep quality. Let me introduce here the staff of the laboratory. We have our medical doctor, Eleftheris Bakas, Professor Panagiotis Bamidis, Chrysoula Kurtidou Papadeli, and the former director of NASA Life Sciences section, Dr. Joan Vernikos. The team has also some postdoc and researchers and PhD students. Special thanks to Dr. Maria Velana, who greatly contributed to the aforementioned analysis. And for the end, I would like to represent the infrastructure of our new lab. You may see here the short arm human centrifuge that performs combination of artificial gravity and aerobic or resistance training exercise, and we simultaneously record blood gas metrics and neurophysiological metrics also. Our activities focused to investigate if this was a proper training, and we found that as we go from a low intensity, 0.5G to 2G, the heart rate intensity greatly and statistically significantly increases. And the same happens for the cardiac output. So the answer is that yes, this is a clinically validated training approach. And we also validated it in patient populations suffering from multiple sclerosis or stroke. This was our first paper published in Frontiers in Physiology. And this was our validation protocol. We employed almost 24 participants for a medium size effect. This is again the short arm human centrifuge, and we started from 0.5G, which gradually increasing to 2.0G. These are the heart rate variability responses, and you may see here that as we move from standing to 2.G, there is an increase in the low frequency, which is the sympathetic branch of the autonomic nervous system, and especially above 1.2G, there is a decrease of the high frequency, which is the branch of the parasympathetic autonomic nervous system. You may see here some graphs that compare heart rate responses with the standing position. The important with those training approaches is to offer the feasibility of standing to patients who cannot walk and are confined to bed. So always we compare our metrics to those observed in the standing position. You may see here the bone plots for the cardiac output. And also we employed some analysis of cortical network properties in order to answer to some research questions. The questions were whether we can differentiate artificial gravity strength from lying or standing condition, which is an intensity level that approximates the standing condition, and also if there is a gender or body mass index effect. So we formed those experimental conditions by grouping some intensity levels. And what we mainly found for local information processing is that it is the maximum during lying, it decreases during standing, it reaches its minimum point during low intensity, and then gradually increases with the intervention maximum observed in high intensity and not very high intensity. So this is the threshold that we mainly use for clinical population. Regarding the information flow quantified by the characteristic path length, we found that it is optimal during lying. It increases during standing, and regarding the training parameters, it reaches its optimal value again during high intensity. For the small cord propensity, we seek the maximum value. We see here that its maximum is on standing position, and regarding training, its maximum is again observed during high intensity. And something similar is also observed again for the network efficiency metric. So we concluded that the optimal intervention parameter for the majority of the patients was the high intensity. For the last minutes of my talk, I would like to present to you my research agenda for the future. It is currently implemented in two Horizon 2020 projects that started the previous month. And we try to estimate how climate change, air quality, and pandemics affect public health. So our challenges and priorities within those projects is the aging population, vulnerable population suffering from mental or mood disorders, and we try to increase the physical health to alleviate social inequalities due to socioeconomic or education differences. And our focus is to shift treatment to prevention and from longevity to quality of life. So this is our approach. We employ a participatory and co-creation design through living labs by involving all the relevant stakeholders, citizens, patient associations, engineers, computer scientists, clinical experts, policymakers, and local authorities in order to identify health and biomarkers that are more indicative of the impact of climate change and atmospheric pollution on vulnerable populations. And then we try to employ precision medicine approaches and evidence-based feedback for helping those vulnerable populations. So the implementation of those projects begin from co-creation through the living labs. Then we go to inside lab assessment and medical examinations. After that, we employ big data analytics through real world and Internet of Things approaches. And finally, our aim is to develop healthcare technologies for the vulnerable ones. This is my Google Scholar profile, if someone is interested to find our publications. And all this work is mainly performed by my PhD students, Pantelis Charis-Kos, who performs the functional activity and the sleep metrics. You may see here the dynamic configuration of the sleeping brain. Also, George Takakis employs augmented reality approaches for interventions that project virtual things in the real world, as you may see here. And also Christina Plomariti, who is an expert of brain networks and cortical activity estimation. So I think that I am on time. I would like to thank you very much for inviting me and being here with you. Dankeschön.